Parazit. There's a kind of spoof in the name itself, right?
Static on static TV? Is that where'd the idea for the name come from?
I think you picked the name, and we picked a couple of names, and then we agreed on static Parazit, which means static, because there was an irony in it. You know, people sitting at home and watching static TV, and there's this TV show that's called Static.
We just made it simple, you know. It's already out there. They put static on they try to put static on every channel that comes from outside. So if we can get through, let's just call ourselves Static and camouflage the name.
So how did this start? What need were you trying to fill?
We're both very passionate in what we do. And we got to a point where we realized, okay, maybe there's time for change and do something that we like even more, step it up to the next level. And I think we have the same thing in common with a lot of younger people, even in the States, who watch the news in a different way. And there's no difference in Iran. So we basically had a concept of what we want to do. We wrote it on a piece of paper. We said, look, what do you guys think of this? And we showed it to our management. They looked at it. They thought it was crazy. But at the time, our main director, he had the sign over his head that said 70 or 75% of Iranian population is below the age of 30.
We're thinking from the beginning of young people, trying to reach young people.
We were thinking about people like us, and that happens to be the most of the population in Iran. And he got it. He understood it. So he's like, okay, it sounds weird, but why don't we just give it a shot? Why don't you guys do a short segment, maybe like a 10-minute segment, and we'll see where it goes. And then we got the opportunity from there.
But we knew that the show is going to work because of what happened after the election in Iran, the aftermath of election. All of a sudden, you had the huge population of youth inside Iran becoming interested in politics overnight. So they were tired of getting entertained by the way they were getting entertained before, and they wanted more politics. And here we come. We have a show that is entertaining and informing and engages all youth with current politics too. The other thing is that people in Iran are very interested in politics, and they talk politics all the time, in taxis, in when they're in line to buy bread, or whenever you see them in public, they're interested to talk politics. And they use this informal way of talking to each other about politics.
Street language.
Street language. Mm. You know, we use that street language, and we spice it with a little bit of humor.
What is so funny about Ahmadinejad?
He's fantastic.
What's not funny about Ahmadinejad? He's a great, it's a gift of God for a show like this.
Greatest writer.
Yeah, he's our main writer.
He gives you his own material, your material.
Always. As soon as this guy opens his mouth, we have a material to work with, because he doesn't make sense whatsoever. Not only from our perspective outside of Iran, but also inside Iran, people know, most of people, that this guy doesn't make any sense. But somehow, he's the president.
When you hear him speak, he speaks like a child to his masses. And I, for some reason, I think he thinks everybody's dumb. And it shows how he's been talked to from his above whatever. And you get a lot of funny stuff out of that, because you look at this serious president with all kinds of crazy ambitions around the world. And he sounds like a kid. His common sense is actually pretty funny, because he speaks like a kid. And the good thing is, you realize why he does that. And the reason is because someone else is talking to him like a kid. So we're able to get these little funny things out of it. It's almost like a kid show, but it's coming out of our president. He says the best things ever. I think Kambiz would have to quit his job if Ahmadinejad wasn't writing all the time for him. I mean, there are other sources too, but Ahmadinejad is definitely on top of the list.
He's very funny. He's, you know, what I have to do with Ahmadinejad is I need to play a soundbite by Ahmadinejad, and at the end of the soundbite, I appear on camera and say, "You're kidding me, right?"
Yeah, you don't need an extra punchline.
He's got the punchline and everything. I just need to react, you know, and to it, and very limited and simple, and people get it, and it's funny.
Same reaction you'd probably have if you heard it, or someone else in their house did. They'd be like, "Did he just say that?"
Yeah,
you know. But that's all we, you know, it speaks volumes.
This is what people say on when they're watching Ahmadinejad, and they're sitting at their home and watching Ahmadinejad. After he says something and finishes his speech, people say, "Did he just say that? Are you kidding, man? What are you smoking? What's going on?"
He's a kid.
This is the reaction I'm giving to people too. So I think that's why people like it, because they see themselves in this show.
But you poke fun at everyone, right? I mean, you poke fun at the opposition, the Green Party.
Trying to be balanced, you know. We can't.
Even Western governments. We've even picked on the United States. You know, this is how you get you keep your credibility. You know, we have a charter, we go by it, and this is why we've stood out in a very different kind of way. Our audience comes from all sides of the opposition groups and political sides of Iran, and this is very unique because you can't get three Iranians to agree on like one issue.
But we do Iran politics the most. We don't care that much about American domestic politics. Mm-hmm. Foreign policy, sometimes we see something funny, we poke fun of.
Is anything off limits?
Mostly religion. You know, we don't touch religion, people's belief.
Touch it.
No, we don't go there at all.
We do unless it's within the news format. You know, because sometimes they use religion as a tool. It's a personal thing that we respect. But if they take it out of, you know, if they use it as a tool to send a political message that's absolutely not right, then we point it out.
We would like to respect people's religious belief, and we don't want to send out this message that we don't respect your religious belief, because this is what Islamic Republic wants us to portray us like, that these people are infidels and they don't believe in any God.
You feel that. I mean, you're aware of that's how they want to come back at you.
This is an old technique that we've been using
forever. And that's not true. You know, we're not here to criticize people's belief or you know, basically we respect their religion that they have and their beliefs that they have inside Iran.
So
we don't
want
to go there.
There are limits to the satire.
This goes back to the whole cultural thing. You know, Iran, for some reason, like here in the States, it might work a little bit better because there's a separation of church and state. In Iran, we've never really had a free democratic society. So religion has always been somewhat stuck in politics and other social issues in Iran. So we have to, you know, be very careful what we say and what we do to make it look like, okay, not to give the Islamic Republic, you know, an extra point by doing something they want us to do.
Sitting here, you've both used the word dude a couple of times, and I hear you use it on your show, too. I imagine that's not something that people hear too often on Iranian television.
We have similar words in Farsi, and I think dude's become very international, I think.
Yeah.
I hope so, right?
No, but look, the combination of me and Saman, he grew up in U.S., I grew up in Iran, and I have this accent, and he has less accent than me. You know, he's got more American accent. The combination is funny for people inside Iran, because they see me as a first-generation immigrant and they see him as a second-generation immigrant. And me and him being together, trying to say...
It's the other way around.
Trying to say the same one message, it's interesting for them to watch.
Yeah, I'm the cousin they lost 25 years ago.
Yeah.
And he's the brother they lost
10 years ago.
So there's a bridge between what we do that still connects to our people in Iran.